Hello, and welcome back to our show, where we journey into the heart of general relativity's secrets and discover that sometimes nature really does play dice just with a geometry-based rulebook. I'm Jennifer, here to talk about what might just be the most important equations in theoretical physics, Einstein's field equation. In previous discussions, we've encountered the notion that mass and energy bend space-time, that objects follow curved geodesics, and that orbits aren't commanded by a mystic gravitational pull, but are simply straight paths in a warped reality. All that's spectacular, but it begs an even bigger question. How do we figure out how space and time bend around a given cluster of mass? More bluntly, if we toss the sun, Earth, or a black hole into the cosmic mix, who decides how the geometry changes? That's exactly where Einstein's field equations come in. In this episode, we'll peel away the intimidating math and look at the conceptual core of these equations, which can be summarized as mass energy tells space-time how to curve, curved space-time tells mass energy how to move. But there's more drama, history, and modern-day confirmations than you might expect from a set of formulae. Let's dive in. If you've spent enough time involved in conversations about relativity, you've likely heard the phrase, mass tells space-time how to curve, curved space-time tells mass how to move. While that might sound like a neat slogan on a t-shirt, it's actually the entire theme of general relativity bottled into one sentence. The field equations embody exactly that cause and effect structure. In essence, these equations tie together two major pieces. The first is mass energy distribution. It refers to the idea that every form of energy or mass in a given region of space-time can be accounted for and logged. In Einstein's theory, it's not just mass in the everyday sense. Any form of energy, like electromagnetic radiation, pressure inside a star, even momentum of particles, contributes to how space-time is curved. Because general relativity sees any energy content as capable of bending space-time, the field equations need a complete tally so that no matter what sort of energy or mass you throw in, space-time's curvature responds accordingly. The second is that the curvature of space-time is essentially the idea that the very geometry, all the distances, angles, and straight lines in space-time changes in the presence of mass or energy. Imagine space-time as a flexible fabric. If a massive object sits on it, the shape of that fabric around the object bends inward. Things passing by, like planets or light beams, then move as though they're traveling on a sloped or dented surface. When you put them side by side, you get something that says, wherever there's more mass or energy, there shall be more curvature. Einstein's field equation can be written as involving the Einstein tensor, the stress energy tensor, the cosmological constant, and the Einstein gravitational constant. It looks complex, but no need to panic. Let's break down each symbol in everyday language. Let's start with the left-hand side, the Einstein tensor. Think of it as a compact summary of how space-time is curved. We know from previous discussions that curvature means distances, angles, and geodesics don't behave the way they would in a flat world. But to predict orbits or gravitational lensing precisely, we need a single mathematical object that combines all those aspects of curvature into one coherent measure. The Einstein tensor is exactly that. It's built out of more fundamental curvature quantities like the Ricci tensor and scalar curvature, and does two big jobs. First, it tells us how volumes or areas might get squeezed or stretched, imagine a rubber sheet, in different regions. Second, it ties that local squeezing slash stretching effect to the geometry at every point, ensuring consistency across the manifold. In short, the Einstein tensor is the geometry side of Einstein's equations. Next up is cosmological constant and the metric tensor. We'll have a lot more to say about cosmological constant in the next episode because it's Einstein's so-called greatest blunder. But for now, cosmological constant is essentially a term that can act like a uniform energy density spread throughout all of space-time. Imagine the entire universe has a built-in background energy that isn't coming from stars or planets, but from space itself. When that happens, the equations show a sort of push, similar to an anti-gravity effect, that can drive the universe's expansion. The metric tensor is the blueprint for measuring distances and times. Think of it like a blueprint or set of instructions that tell you how to measure things. Distances, angles, even durations of time, at each point in your space-time fabric. In the actual universe, where space-time can curve around massive objects, those measuring instructions, i.e. the values of the metric tensor, vary from place to place. That means a meter near a black hole might not correspond to the same meter out in the emptiness of interstellar space. When multiplied, these terms effectively add a universal push or pull, possibly driving cosmic acceleration. If cosmological constant is zero, you get a simpler set of equations. If not, you might have a runaway expansion, like dark energy. Einstein originally added this term to keep the universe static, but later called it a mistake. Yet modern data suggests it might solve the riddle of an accelerating cosmos. Moving to the right-hand side, we see a set of universal constants that keep the equation balanced. It includes Newton's gravitational constant from classical gravity, the speed of light, and, well, pi. The fraction ensures that when we measure mass or energy, we convert it properly into geometric curvature. Finally, we have the stress-energy tensor, that cosmic ledger we introduced earlier. It tracks everything from the density of matter to the flow of momentum, from electromagnetic fields to pressure in a star's core. In other words, if you have more matter slash energy jammed into one spot, the stress-energy tensor spikes there. It's a whole table of how energy and momentum shift in space and time. It's multidimensional, telling you not only how much energy is present, but also in which direction it's moving or pressuring. Putting it all together, and in simpler terms, the equation claims that the bending of space-time, left side, is something proportional to the energy and momentum present, right side. If you have zero matter slash energy, no cosmological constant, then space-time might remain flat or follow simpler vacuum solutions. If you throw in stars, black holes, or cosmic inflation, the equation modifies the geometry accordingly. The reason this equation is so critical is because it unifies all gravitational phenomena under one umbrella. Instead of having separate theories for orbits, star formation, or cosmic expansion, we use a single equation that says mass energy is geometry's driver, geometry is mass energy's stage. It's a neat cause and effect dance, all spelled out in one line of algebra that's surprisingly short, yet unbelievably broad in scope. Each symbol and the constants plays a distinct role, capturing geometry, uniform vacuum effects, measuring rods, cosmic currency conversions, and energy distributions. Combine them, and you get the simplest yet most profound statement. Gravity is geometry, shaped by what's inside the universe. So how do Einstein's field equations explain some of the strange phenomena we observe in the universe? delve deeper, and you discover entire classes of weird predictions, scenarios that might seem ripped from science fiction, yet come as a result of varying assumptions in the field equation. Black holes, white holes, and collapsing geometry. Perhaps the best known bizarre solution is the black hole. Solve the field equations for a massive object collapsing under its own gravity with minimal pressure or rotation, and you get an event horizon, a point of no return, plus a central singularity where density shoots toward infinity. That single solution, the Schwarzschild metric for non-rotating, or Kerr metric for spinning black holes, is fully spelled out by the same piece of mathematics that explains Mercury's orbit. And if you thought black holes were strange, think again. There is something even weirder than a prediction that comes out of field equations, namely white holes. White holes pop out if you reverse time in certain solutions. You get a region where matter can only exit, never enter. It sounds unphysical and no one's observed one, but again, it's the unaltered equations that predict it if you allow those symmetrical boundary conditions. Then we have gravitational waves and ripples in reality. In a flat Newtonian world, space doesn't undulate. Yet in Einstein's math, if you let two massive objects, like black holes, spiral into each other, the field equations show that their changing stress energy distribution sends out traveling waves in spacetime. These ripples are no more than the geometry adjusting to violently changing mass configurations. The fact that we've actually detected these waves with LIGO proves that the equation's more exotic solutions aren't just abstract. The geometry does flex and vibrate like a cosmic trampoline. Field equations also present the mind-bending possibility of negative mass or negative energy. If you assume some exotic form of stress energy, the stuff on the right side of the equation, the geometry on the left side can respond by forming bizarre curves that lead to hypothetical phenomena like repulsive gravity. We don't know if such matter or energy can exist physically, but the math under Einstein's rules is flexible enough that if it did, geometry would get even stranger. Think warp drives or stable wormholes. Next up is the tantalizing possibility of a wormhole. Wormholes are hypothetical tunnels in spacetime, possibly connecting distant regions or different universes. If they exist, they might allow near-instant travel, though none have been empirically observed yet. Nothing in the fundamental structure of the field equations automatically bans a wormhole. Basically, a handle or shortcut bridging two distant points in spacetime. The simplest wormhole solutions often require negative energy to keep them open, which is why we call them exotic solutions. If we discovered a real form of negative energy material, the equations say a traversable wormhole might be stable, potentially allowing for shortcuts or time travel paradoxes. In short, these phenomena aren't add-ons or separate theories. They pop out from the exact same equation. All that changes is the content. What kind of energy distribution you assume, the boundary conditions or the initial setups, like an imploding star or a hypothetical negative energy region. The geometry side, the left-hand terms, then dutifully reshape space-time to match, producing everything from gravitational waves to wormholes. That coherence is why Einstein's equations have reigned supreme for a century. They unify the everyday and the bizarre under one universal law of gravity as geometry. Which bizarre scenarios actually exist out there is a question for astronomers, gravitational wave observers, and future experiments to test. But the fact that a single line of math can handle black hole collisions, cosmic expansion, and hypothetical warp drives is a testament to the broad power of Einstein's field equation. Instead of layering new force laws or gravity modifications for each new phenomenon, one equation can generate them all, if you let it.